wanna smash, crash, bash, mash, blast the system. We wanna get it hype, get it live, get with the mission. We want the crowd loud, fist pumping, rhythm is hitting. We wanna make it clear, we ain't scared. This is the vision we want, we want, we want, we want. We wanna liberate and land, supporting human conditions, not free market propaganda and corrupt politicians.
Welcome to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. On today's program, we are celebrating the release of Project Censored's State of the Free Press 2021. I'll be joined by the Associate Director of Project Censored and the co-editor of the volume, Dr. Andy Lee Roth. Today on the Project Censored Show, we'll talk about the State of the Free Press 2021. Stay with us.
Unthinkable crimes perpetrated by the criminal minds, political ties, habitualized alibis, disguised under the guise of democracy, politics, and the apocalypse. Got the skies looking ominous. So the ocean burned bright with waves full of poison. Genocide wars fought for little boys, and the weapons manufactured paid for by taxes, while the bridges and the levees and the mines collapsing. All the prisons build the capacity citizens. In the times for the master thief, divine and conquer, steal a masterpiece. Open your eyes and realize what's happening. Times running out the reach, all potential fame at the table, then you probably own the menu.
Welcome back to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. On today's program, we are going to spend time with the Associate Director of Project Censored, Andy Lee Roth. Andy is the Associate Director and co-editor of Project Censored State of the Free Press 2021 that I co-edited with him. This is the annual release that looks at the top 25 most underreported stories and analyzes the news that doesn't make the news and tells us why. Let me take this opportunity to reintroduce Andy Lee Roth to you. He is certainly no stranger to our audience here. Andy Lee Roth is Associate Director of Project Censored and co-editor of 10 previous editions of the Project Censored Yearbook. He coordinates the project's Campus Affiliates Program, a news media research network of several hundred students and faculty at 24 colleges and universities across North America. Roth's research and writing have been published in a variety of outlets, including Index on Censorship, In These Times, Yes Magazine, Media, Culture, and Society, and the International Journal of Press and Politics. He earned a PhD in Sociology at the University of California, Los Angeles, and a BA in Sociology and Anthropology at Haverford College. He lives in Seattle, Washington. Andy Lee Roth, welcome back to the Project Censored Show.
Thanks so much, Mickey. It's a pleasure to join you again.
Absolutely, Andy. It's always great to talk about the work of Project Censored, talking about it with you. 10 previous editions of the yearbook. Our newest book, Project Censored, State of the Free Press 2021, is out, and we are the co-editors. We have a foreword by Matt Taibbi this year, which is a stellar foreword. And so, Andy, let's just jump right into the conversation about the state of our so-called free press. What are some of the big themes here for this year?
We talk in the introduction to the book about how the COVID-19 pandemic has exposed, in effect, compound fractures in American society. Everything from structural weaknesses in fundamental U.S. institutions to what we know now as a kind of national malignancy of systemic racism and economic inequality. What Jelani Cobb in a May 2020 New Yorker article described the COVID pandemic as a crisis multiplied and cubed. And what we talk about, Mickey, you and I, in the introduction to the book, is how journalism has not been immune to this crisis. And there really are, I think, two trends that were already underway before the crisis began that has been accelerated by the pandemic, that leave journalism in a perilous position today. The first of those are economic impacts on journalism. And as we report in State of the Free Press 2021, thousands and thousands of employees of journalistic organizations have been laid off, furloughed, or had their pay reduced. This is everything from small local news organizations, the weekly papers in small communities, all the way up to big, well-established legacy organizations. The economic impacts of the pandemic on journalism as a profession have been so profound that the Poynter Institute which is maintaining an online listing of all the newsroom layoffs, furloughs, and closures caused by the coronavirus, has to be updated almost daily. So the economic impacts of the pandemic on journalism are one, I think, key component of any assessment in 2020, 2021 of the state of the free press in the United States.
Remind our listeners and explain to them this whole process of how we're reviewing and vetting on that timeline so people aren't confused when we use these dates.
Until we have the Project Censored crystal ball that allows us to see into the future for the important stories of 2021, our process is to some extent a reflective, retrospective process. That process takes place over the course of an entire year, and it involves literally hundreds of students and faculty at dozens of college and university campuses across the country who initially identify and vet candidate stories that we post on the website when they meet the criteria of the project that we post as validated independent news stories. And those are all archived online at projectcensored.org. As the year's cycle continues, we reach a stage in the year, usually in early spring, when all of the contributors, the faculty and students who have identified and vetted stories, join together in voting to determine, out of several hundred news stories, approximately three dozen, that are then forwarded along to the project's panel of 28 esteemed international judges who ultimately vote to determine the rank order of the top 25 list. Those judges are luminaries from the world of journalism. They are media scholars and media activists. We have a former FCC commissioner, Nicholas Johnson, who served as one of our judges for quite a long time. It's a very diverse group of people. And so as we note in the book every year, when we bring forward our top 25 list, our annual top 25 list, we're very confident in the claims that the stories that are included in that list are not only important and significant and high quality in terms of the journalistic standards, but also that those stories have in one way or another been marginalized or distorted or simply ignored altogether by the corporate media, by the establishment press of the United States. So those stories are often challenging psychologically because they call into question cherished notions of who we are, what we stand for, what the history and the policies of the United States look like. But they're stories that we feel by the time we bring them forward, by the time they've undergone this year-long process of identification, vetting, and multiple rounds of judging, we're confident that they are important and worthy of the public's attention.
A major series of developments as our book was going to press around the George Floyd protests, social justice protests around racism and police brutality. As we note every year, when the book is going to the publishers at Seven Stories Press in New York, the world doesn't stop for us to take its temperature, so to speak.
This begins to touch on a second major trend in terms of the state of the free press in the United States. As I mentioned, Jelani Cobb talking about this as a crisis multiplied and cubed. One multiplier there, one exponential multiplier, was the police killing of George Floyd in late May and the social protests that erupted first in St. Paul and Minneapolis in the immediate aftermath and then spreading rapidly to cities across the country and indeed in many cases around the world. Those protests were in many ways well covered, but there was a secondary story that goes to the heart of what Project Censored is about that I know, Mickey, you have dedicated previous episodes of the Project Censored radio show to addressing this, but I just want to remind listeners, in the immediate aftermath of George Floyd's killing, the week of May 26th to June 3rd, the U.S. Press Freedom Tracker and the Committee to Protect Journalists, two groups that, as their names suggest, track any kind of infringements on the ability of journalists to do their job and to do their job safely, they documented as many as 280 press freedom violations in the United States in that single week alone. And of those 280 that were under investigation, fully 83% of them were at the hands of police officers and or other law enforcement officials. So we're talking about arrests, we're talking about assaults that include not only physical attacks, but also tear gassings, pepper sprayings, rubber bullets and projectiles. We're talking about equipment, cameras and microphones being damaged. And many of those attacks by the police were clearly targeted on journalists as journalists. There were dozens of videos showing that police could see clearly that the people being subject to assault, subject to tear gassing, subject to pepper spraying were journalists with press badges, and those attacks happened anyway. So that's the most close to home and blunt version of what has been a global crackdown on journalism under the COVID-19 pandemic. As Trevor Tim reported in The Intercept, it was a truly unprecedented attack on press freedom in the United States in the aftermath of the killing of George Floyd by Minneapolis police. But we've also seen countries from around the world, everywhere from Venezuela to Scotland, national governments have been cracking down on freedom of information laws, crackdowns in as many as 126 countries on the freedom of information laws that journalists use to do their job and to inform the public. So the state of the free press under the COVID-19 pandemic globally and under a combination of the COVID-19 pandemic and the concerns about institutional racism in the United States in particular, the state of the free press, as I mentioned earlier in our conversation today, is a perilous one.
Of course, listeners can go to projectcensored.org to learn more about some of these stories. We've certainly covered them here at the Project Censored Show. You can also go to the Press Freedom Tracker website, pressfreedomtracker.us. There have been nearly 1,000 reported press violations, press freedom violations from national social justice protests alone just this year.
And to put that in perspective, to put that number in perspective, in all of 2019, U.S. Press Freedom Tracker, I believe, identified 150 violations in the United States. So we're talking about, the year isn't even over yet, and we're talking about nearly a tenfold increase in those violations.
I'd like to remind our listeners that you're tuned to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. And on the line right now, we have Dr. Andy Lee Roth. He is the Associate Director of Project Censored, works with me at Project Censored. We work together. Andy and I have done 9 Censored volumes together. Today, we're taking time to talk about our newest book, which is Project Censored, State of the Free Press 2021. And after this musical break, Andy Lee Roth will be back, and we'll talk more about the state of the free press. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. Today, we welcome to the show Dr. Andy Lee Roth. He is Associate Director of Project Censored. He's co-editor with me of State of the Free Press 2021, Project Censored's latest book with 7 Stories Press out of New York. You can go to 7 Stories website. You can go to projectcensored.org to learn more about this critical media literacy project and publication. Each year, we do this annual book on the most underreported or censored stories of the year. And Andy Lee Roth is with us. He is also the coordinator of our campus affiliate program, and he oversees the validated independent news stories that are sent in and researched each year. He's been doing that this year with Dr. Steve Masick from North Central College in Illinois. And Andy Roth, before the break, you and I were talking about the state of the free press, crackdowns on journalism, violence against journalists in general. It's been quite a year, but I'd like to get to some of the other stories, maybe some of the other concepts that we deal with here at Project Censored. One of the kinds of censorship that we deal with isn't simply total omission. It's the way that corporate media narrowly focus the topics that they cover. So it's not such that necessarily a, quote, censored story has never been covered. Obviously, if it's never covered, we don't know about it. But when it's covered in the independent press, sometimes people will say, well, wait a minute, I've heard that story, and I've seen that in the New York Times or cable news, etc. But let's talk a little bit more about the censorship definition, and let's talk a little bit more about the structural shortcomings of the corporate press.
I think we're almost all reflexively critical of news content and journalism today. And I say we to include people from across a variety of political perspectives. But that reflexive critique, I think, is often kind of a shallow one. The need to go beneath the surface is never more evident, I think, than when we're trying to understand that slippery topic of news bias or news slant. Obviously, we can talk about what's in the news, but in many ways, the project has been founded and has continued to thrive on the idea of keeping track of what hasn't been covered. What's going on outside of the picture frame? If the frame of a picture or a frame of a window guides your attention to see this, look at this, notice these things, it's always a kind of critical perspective to say, but wait, what's beyond the frame? What's outside of the frame? What's omitted or blocked by the frame? My training is as a sociologist, and so when I got interested in the news, I was quickly immersed in the history of various sociological studies have tried to make sense of the news and how news content is produced. One of the most famous studies, not unique to sociology, I think it's taught in communications and media courses as well. One of the most famous studies is one from the 1950s by a researcher named David Manning White, who spent time with the wire editor of a Midwestern newspaper. Manning White, the researcher, called the wire editor Mr. Gates. And the idea was that Mr. Gates, the wire editor, in his daily job would have stories coming across the news wire. It would be his job to decide which of those to include in the daily contents of the newspaper. And so what Manning White was interested in was how did Gates decide what to include and what to exclude? Some of the stories were excluded on the grounds that they were boring, they weren't interesting, they were old, they were stale. Some of the stories Mr. Gates rejected on the ground that they were too red, they were political, probably we would say today propaganda. Anyway, David Manning White was able to study this process, which he's famously referred to as gatekeeping. He could witness firsthand how Mr. Gates, the wire editor at this small Midwestern newspaper, made those decisions. Let's fast forward 70 years. There are still, of course, editors who make decisions about what appears in the day's newspaper and so forth. But increasingly, in our news environment, these decisions are made invisibly by things that seem inhuman or non-human. We have today Facebook's algorithms and Google's algorithms filtering what we know about what's happening in the world. An algorithm is an artificial intelligence set of procedures to find a solution to a problem. And in this case, whether we're talking about Google or Facebook, these algorithms are proprietary, meaning the companies that created them claim the exclusive rights to them. There's no public access to scrutinize how they work. You can't be a David Manning White today and examine how Google News's algorithm parses the items it sends back to you when you punch in a news search for, say, LGBTQ plus issues. So there's no equivalent today of a David Manning White observing and reporting the decisions made by a Mr. Gates. And I think that's one way that news has changed profoundly, certainly in our lifetimes, and really in the lifetimes of the students that we teach. And so if we're understanding 21st century news, the 21st century news ecosystem, the development of these proprietary algorithms is one major development.
This is a new type, new manifestation, let's say, of censorship technologically that you just described that is seemingly invisible to, for lack of a better term, and to use the sloppy marketplace language, news consumers. But as Mark Crispin Miller noted in our recent documentary, when we consume the news, that implies we're not critically thinking about it or how it's made or what goes into it or what's left out of it, which you just spent time explaining. And then that raises this other question then, that as we've seen a rise in the concern about so-called fake news, as the Trump administration has weaponized that term, we've seen calls from various sectors of society, from Congress to concerned citizens about, well, what are we going to do about the fake news problem? And so there's been a lot of people jumping on board the bandwagon saying, well, they're going to fight fake news. But the way that social media companies or big tech companies are dealing with fake news is algorithmically or with bots. They're winnowing and they're taking things out that we don't even see. And so that big question looming over it, looming over this whole phenomenon, is who's checking the fact checkers? This is something that we've certainly talked about at length, both in the last couple of books and again comes up here in State of the Free Press 2021.
Another one that I know we've been talking a lot about, Mickey, is the rise of would-be fact checkers and fake news detectors like NewsGuard. So NewsGuard is one of the most prominent of these operations that's emerged and been widely endorsed in the corporate media as the life preserver that's cast out to us so we don't drown in a sea of fake news. We talked some about this in State of the Free Press 2021, a kind of attempt to analyze in terms of the values of journalism as a profession, how it is that NewsGuard has achieved this sort of lofty status. And I think there are two dimensions to this. The first is from the standpoint of kind of corporate news media, NewsGuard is a trustworthy judge of fake news because it's partnered with major corporate entities like Microsoft, on one hand, and also because its advisory board includes a number of former government officials who tidily fit establishment news media's standard, if narrow, criteria for who's newsworthy. So you have as examples of people on the advisory board of NewsGuard, which is going to protect us from fake news. Those include people like Tom Ridge, who was the first director of Homeland Security, and Michael Hayden, who ran the CIA when George W. Bush was the president. So on one hand, you have the corporate media holding up NewsGuard as they can protect us. These people know about security risks and the like. On the other hand, you have another version of what journalism is or could be at its best, basic kind of principles of journalism, like that sources ought to be transparently identified. News coverage ought to highlight, for instance, who Tom Ridge is, who Michael Hayden is, and why it might be a concern that they're on a board that will be guiding us in our assessments of what we can trust as newsworthy and what we should dismiss as fraudulent or fake. There's serious doubts, I think, about the fact-checking organization's credibility, and I would add its ultimate purpose. But you don't see a lot of stories in the corporate press about that, and that's a failure.
It's a failure. It certainly was one addressed in the last book before with Emil Marmol. This so-called fact-checking and vetting for fake news was actually a way to reestablish corporate dominance over news media and further marginalize the independent press. So Project Censored's focus on the independent news sources isn't only to point out negative issues with the corporate press. It's to highlight and champion what a truly free press can look like.
I think it's our colleague and dear friend Peter Phillips who directed the project before you became director, Mickey. It was Peter who coined the term validated independent news stories as a kind of label for the stories that the project identifies, vets, and tries to bring to wider public attention. And I think Peter chose that term validated very carefully. The idea was that for many people, there's already a kind of inbuilt halo of trustworthiness around some of the major establishment news outlets of the country. But their challenges, as we go down to less well-known organizations, they are doing better work than the public gives them credit for or than the public is aware of. We tracked in this year's book, there was an amazing column in the Here to Help section of the New York Times. That's a feature that runs every Sunday in the main section of the New York Times, that venerable newspaper. And the column that we draw some attention to was how to determine whether a news story is trustworthy or not. And the advice from the New York Times Here to Help columnist on this was that if you hadn't ever heard of that news organization before, or of that outlet before, it probably existed only to promote fake news. But the article went on and said, if you find outlets reporting a story that no one else has covered, again, it's probably fake, because if it was a legitimate story, lots of people would be reporting it. And I was reading this about the time that you and I were doing the final edits and revisions to the book before we sent it off for publication. And I was just thinking about the host of stories featured in this year's top 25 list and every year's top 25 list, that the reason those stories are in the list, the reason we continue to do what we do, is that the corporate news media, including the New York Times, have failed to adequately cover those stories. And that in many cases, those stories are reported by news organizations that are entirely legit and professional, in the best sense of that word, news organizations, but that many, if not most, Americans have never heard of. So by the standards of the New York Times Here to Help column, all of these stories would basically be dismissed as not credible, when in fact, I would argue, they're the most important and significant reporting we have from the previous year. So, I mean, I think you can see how with a story like that, which incidentally, that story ran in the print section of the New York Times, but to my knowledge, it has never reappeared in digital format online. And I wonder if the Times didn't get some flack from people other than folks like us at Project Censored about how biased those claims were as a guide to avoiding misleading reporting. It's the hegemonic quality of the New York Times, where they literally mean all the news that's fit to print as we see fit. In sociology, we talk about hegemony, which is a fancy word for the idea that there's consent to relations of power by those who are subject to them. In other words, you accept it as legitimate. And so I think this is a way in which the Times plays a hegemonic role as a kind of macro now gatekeeper. If we didn't report this, it must not be legitimate news.
It's the New York Times at its propagandistic worst to maintain that place and to displace anyone with whom they might disagree. I'd like to remind our listeners, you're tuned to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. We're speaking with the Associate Director of Project Censored, Dr. Andy Lee Roth, who's co-editor of the new book, Project Censored, State of the Free Press. And after this musical break, we will return with Andy Lee Roth and we'll continue about the state of our free press. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. Right now, we're speaking with the Associate Director of Project Censored, co-editor of Project Censored State of the Free Press 2021, Dr. Andy Lee Roth. He has co-edited 10 previous versions of Project Censored's annual book. Before the break, we were talking about a lot of different structural critiques of the news media, and one of the things that came up was the framework of the way that major establishment outlets define news and how they, at the same time, marginalize lesser-known, or independent voices. And so we at Project Censored take a look at these independent voices, and we validate these independent news stories through critical media literacy education with our students. And Andy Lee Roth is also the coordinator for the project's affiliates program. We work with over 20 campuses across the United States, hundreds of students, dozens of faculty that are actually teaching people how to understand and think critically about the media. And so we're talking about some of these issues. And Andy Lee Roth, that leads me to another issue about what we do at Project Censored, because a lot of people will write us and they'll say, hey, there's a breaking issue here. There's a really big story that you're not covering. And so I wanted to take this opportunity for you to help define and describe a little bit more about what Project Censored does as a media studies organization, an organization involved in critical media literacy education. We're not so much a breaking news organization. Can you talk a little bit about that and how that connects to the research that we do in the project?
The first thing to say is, of course, we always welcome when listeners to this show or people from the public more generally have tips for us on stories or topics that they think are not being adequately covered in the corporate media. We always welcome those. That said, yeah, there's a real contrast, I think, between what the project does as a media watchdog organization and as a critical media literacy education organization and what happens in a typical newsroom on any given day. A typical newsroom now works on a 24/7 news cycle, and there are many great advantages to that kind of speedy reporting. But we also know it's very well documented that that kind of reporting leaves us vulnerable to what Carl Jensen called news inflation. Carl Jensen, the founder of the project, called news inflation, the idea that we have more and more of it, but it seems to be worth less and less. And I think Carl, decades before we had the language of hot takes or clickbait-driven reporting, Carl saw the trends that were developing in the profession he'd grown up in. So on one hand, we have a 24/7 news cycle, which is how most of journalism operates now since the development of the cable news network, 24-hour news reporting. On the other hand, what Project Censored does, we talk, Mickey, you and I, in the introduction to State of the Free Press 2021 about how Project Censored in many ways operates on what you could think of as a 52-12 news cycle. There's 52 weeks and 12 months in a year. And Project Censored in many ways is taking a long view on news and the trends in news. And we recognize that that means we're probably not the best source for daily breaking news coverage, though, of course, this radio program consistently reports on important developing stories as they're happening. But the 52-12 perspective that the project champions allows us to see things that I think get lost in the dizzying 24/7 news cycle that is more typical. We're able to identify and analyze, as we've been talking about today, systemic patterns and what you could think of as subsurface trends in news coverage that otherwise remain invisible or taken for granted. And again, as a sociologist, when I first learned about the project, this appealed to me greatly because I had read Gay Tuckman's critique of news, her famous book from 1978, which sounds like a long time ago and in many ways is, but so many of Gay Tuckman's points in her book, Making News, are still valid today. One I would point to right now is her observation that for journalists, the journalistic orientation is largely towards events rather than issues. So anything that is kind of a long-term systemic social problem may be less newsworthy in the eyes of journalists and editors working on 24/7 deadlines. The news, in other words, from that point of view, is about what went wrong today rather than about what goes wrong every day. And that's why, for instance, in our top 25 list this year, you see stories in the project's top 25 story list this year, you see stories and issues that reflect kind of blind spots in the corporate news media when it comes to reporting on systemic social problems, things like the deadly consequences of enduring economic inequality, the erosion of workers' rights, attacks on freedom of expression, as well as solutions-oriented reporting on stories like voting and public banks and access to affordable medicines. These stories that address systemic, enduring social problems are less likely to be covered in the flurry of a 24/7 news cycle because they don't develop in the same time frame. The news phases that reporters orient to and the phases of important developments in these systemic social problems are out of sync with one another. And so in many cases, reporters and news organizations, establishment reporters and establishment news organizations, are literally blind to these stories. They cannot see them.
That's pretty amazing to consider. One would think that on one level, the analysis, until you really break it down from 24/7 to 52/12, we're also asking people to slow down and take not just more critical, but bigger picture views. Is that correct?
I think that's exactly right. The idea of slowing down is something that reminds me of a really brilliant set of points in one of my favorite books of this past year, Nolan Higdon's The Anatomy of Fake News. And I believe you've had Nolan on the show to talk about that book. And in Nolan's book, the final chapter is a 10-point fake news detection kit. Here, Nolan outlines, I think, a critical media literacy-grounded alternative to the news guard guardians that we were talking about earlier. But what I want to point to here is, in the context of your talking about slowing down and the advantages of slowing down to better understand, a lot of the 10 points in Nolan Higdon's fake news detection kit in The Anatomy of Fake News involve slowing down and asking questions. So things like, this story upset me. Should I react or should I investigate? Why was my attention drawn to this? Does the evidence hold up under scrutiny? Are there false dilemmas? Is there circular reasoning? Am I being galled by ad hominem attacks? And finally, where Nolan leaves off is the idea of what's missing from the story. And again, that just comes full circle around to, you don't notice what's missing if you're moving so fast that you can barely see what's in front of you.
Part of this moving so fast is that the 24/7 cycle that we become attuned to, we become trained in our culture, just like you could be trained to grow up and read the newspaper or watch the evening news. Now, news is ubiquitous, and it's not just news, as Matt Taibbi points out. It's very sensationalist. It's hyperpartisan. Project Censored has long critiqued this, but can you talk a little bit about that type of formulaic corporate reporting that the whole 52/12 cycle defies and calls out?
It's a fundamental truism in the sociology of news production that journalism works and journalists are able to do their job on a daily basis because of conventions, because of socially shared ways of addressing recurrent problems. So we talk about news as conventional, and that's not a critique in itself. Journalists rely on ready-made recipe-like formulas for how to report a story, and that's what allows them to meet the deadlines on a daily basis. So there are real practical, professional reasons for journalism taking conventional forms. And journalism isn't the only profession where that's true. In a longer conversation in one of my sociology of media courses, we would talk about how conventions operate in a variety of art worlds, everything from music and theater to ballet and movies. So conventions allow humans in general to coordinate their activity together to address regularly occurring problems so that a product can be made in a predictable and timely way. And that's just as true of the news as it is of any other product. The downside, of course, is that news is almost as vital to us as clean air and clean water if we're thinking about having a well-informed population that can sustain a democracy. And that's where I think you and I got going one day in kind of a funny but humor is often telling way, joking about Mad Lib news, where, you know, if you grew up in a certain generation, you remember Mad Libs as the stories where there would be blanks in the middle of a sentence that would tell you fill in an adjective here, add a verb here, come up with a noun here. And then your partner who's been writing those down as you've been saying things like green jello and wildly reads back the sentence to you. And it's a coherent sentence, but it's a kaleidoscope view of what whatever the topic might have been. And sometimes, especially, I think, under the Trump administration and the likes of Sean Spicer and other of the press secretaries who have been the interface between the president and the journalists for the past 3 or 4 years, it's felt like a kind of Mad Lib news world, to right. say the least.
Insert fake news here. Insert political party here. Insert mm-hmm. public policy issue here. Insert adjective there. Insert news agency here, right?
Yeah, I mean, so I think as Matt Taibbi points out in his foreword, more and more, this is a subtle but important point, more and more we are being prepared to understand the world in conflictual terms, where the terms of those conflicts in terms of domestic U.S. politics are Republicans and Democrats or conservatives and liberals. And if that provides the kind of Mad Lib framework, then it's, as you just suggested, just add in, you know, Democrats did this, Republicans did this, right? And I think part of Taibbi's critique is that it's, and this jibes with what Project Censored overall is doing, is that consumers of news, uncritical consumers of news, quickly become socialized to understand all news in terms of political partisan conflict. And it, there may be aspects of our life where that is properly the frame of interpretation, but there are many aspects of life, many newsworthy issues, where that framework, the framework of partisan political conflict, fails to provide us a meaningful or even adequate understanding of what's happening in the world. For instance, any issue where there is bipartisan blame becomes almost incomprehensible or invisible as a news topic. So things like warrantless surveillance, drone warfare, regulatory capture, even police brutality are harder to make sense of in terms of a blame game between conservatives and liberals, because in some sense, those are bipartisan public issues, bipartisan social problems. They can't be defined or understood exclusively in terms of that divide.
I'd like to remind listeners that you're tuned to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. We're speaking today with Dr. Andy Lee Roth. He's the associate director of Project Censored. He is co-editor of Project Censored State of the Free Press 2021, and we will come back after this musical break, and we'll conclude our conversation with Andy Lee Roth. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. In today's program, we've been talking with Dr. Andy Lee Roth. He is the Associate Director of Project Censored. He is co-editor of the new book, Project Censored, State of the Free Press 2021 by Seven Stories Press. Andy Lee Roth is a sociologist by training, has a PhD from UCLA. He is also the coordinator of Project Censored's Campus Affiliates program, and we've been talking with Andy about the state of the free press today, and of course, we've been talking about some of the new analysis and stories in Project Censored's State of the Free Press 2021. Andy Lee Roth, before the break, we were talking about formulaic reporting, and you were alluding to Matt Taibbi's foreword in the book, and we were starting to talk about the great partisanship, the hyper-partisanship of media, and it reminded me, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about Taibbi in a moment, but it also reminded me going back to the beginning of Project Censored with Carl Jensen and Junk Food News. One of the critiques was, well, we don't just want to look at what the media isn't covering. He said, what about what they are covering? Because some of the critiques that people in news media had, and they offered to Carl, hey, we only have so much time and we only have so many column inches. But you've already mentioned to us about the problem of news inflation. And we've got the 24/7 cycle that you just analyzed and offered a different way of looking at that. But Project Censored does still look at this junk food news, what Peter Phillips called news abuse or propaganda. These are other things that are covered in Project Censored's work every year as well. But the whole issue of sensationalism, and we just got through this very contentious election cycle. And when you were talking about Matt Taibbi's foreword and the hyperpartisan frames, again, could not help but think about this great partisan divide in the way election coverage goes on in the corporate media, like with the horse race polls and who's ahead of whom. It's almost covered like some sudden death in some sporting event, overtime, and there's fever pitch in the way that it's covered. That kind of sustained, quote, reporting almost borders on the hysterical.
In this year's book, we have a fantastic chapter on news abuse by Robin Anderson, a great friend of the project and a professor of communication and media studies at Fordham University that many people know from her work with FAIR, Fairness and Accuracy in Reporting. Robin, in that news abuse chapter, talks about the double standards and skewed framing that have distorted news coverage about the COVID-19 pandemic, about the debates over healthcare during the 2020 Democratic primary campaign, and also the mass demonstrations that have taken place in Hong Kong and in Chile. It's a wonderful chapter, and Robin's analysis is lucid, and she writes about it in a gripping way. But you mentioned the election, and I think in some ways, the point I'm about to make is more simple than any of Robin's analysis in the news abuse chapter in the book. I think in some ways you could make the argument that the horse race coverage of elections, the who's ahead and by how much, who's gaining, who's losing ground, what is often criticized as horse race coverage, is itself fundamentally a form of news abuse in the sense that Peter Phillips intended that term when he coined the concept. It's a form of spin that distorts the significance. Of course, in an election is a competitive event, and it matters who wins and who loses. We've never had a more profound example of that than in the 2020 elections. But if the election process in a democracy is supposed to be about more than just who the winner is, if you're idealistic enough to believe, as I do, that an election campaign ought to help clarify the issues and the values and the policies that are at stake, the horse race coverage that is the main course of any day's news serving on the establishment media, the horse race coverage doesn't really do much to nourish us. It's important, of course, but its significance is blown out of proportion by the amount of attention devoted to that aspect of the campaign as opposed to more substantive issues.
Well, indeed. And Matt Taibbi also refers to the way the news media cover things as sort of like a wrestling match, like a WWE kind of event that really is, as he puts it, sort of raising an audience of finger pointers who won't or can't hear certain kinds of news, particularly if it's bad news about them or how they associate with things politically. Could you comment on that?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think that that's in some ways, Taibbi said it as clearly as can be said. I think the challenge is then, if that's the reality, that news as an institution, corporate news as an institution, would socialize us as consumers to want certain kinds of things, then the sociologist in me says, okay, what are the monkey wrenches we throw into that system to deconstruct that socialization process, to disarm that socialization process so that we can shape ourselves in better ways, so that we can shape ourselves to be, as I think Nolan Higdon and our colleague Allison Butler talk about, to be not news consumers, but news citizens. Citizens in the sense that we have a stake in the news, that it's important to us, not just as a commodity, but as a basis on which we can make informed and engaged choices. And I think if that's true, I want to, since I know our time may be coming to an end here, I'm thinking of a clock metaphor that I think is very powerful for showing the difference between being a consumer of the news and having critical media literacy. If you think about an old-fashioned wristwatch and you look at it, it has the hands, and it has, we all learn early on, the big hand and the little hand. So we know that when the big hand is pointing at the 12 and the little hand is pointing at 3, it's 3 o'clock, right? Hours and minutes are symbolized by the movement of the big hand and the little hand around the face of the watch. If you think about how most people go about consuming the news, or talking especially about bias in the news, we might be arguing about, hey, that clock is running fast, or that clock is running slow. It says it's 3:30 when it's really 3:25, right? That's not accurate. That's not factually correct. That's fake news. I think what we're doing, and I have this watch metaphor, I want to pay homage here. One of my mentors at UCLA in sociology used this metaphor as a way of understanding how sociology encourages us to look beneath the surface of things and understand underlying structures and mechanisms. Manny Shagloff, my teacher at UCLA, gave this metaphor to me, and I'm adapting it to talking about news and journalism. If you think about this wristwatch now, if you're interested in doing more than just telling what time it is, if you're interested in, say, repairing that watch when it no longer works, you need to know something more than how to read the little hand, big hand on the face of the watch. You need to go underneath the face of the watch to get into the mechanisms, the springs, the gears, the wheels that are invisible from the face of the watch, but that are actually driving the running of the hands around the face of the watch, right? And so in this metaphor, then, the gears, the wheels, the springs of the wristwatch are the structural processes and professional routines and professional values that shape how journalists and editors do their jobs on a daily basis. And if we don't understand those, if we don't understand the competitive pressures, the economic pressures, the legal and political pressures that journalists are under, we don't really understand what makes the watch tick.
We're running out of time in this segment, and that's a good way to kind of segue into our conclusion and loop back around to where we were starting when we were talking about the state of the free press, the attacks against journalists, the various kinds of censorship that are taking place. And this is all happening in a climate where we have mostly 5-6 corporations controlling 90% of the media. And one of the things that we discuss in the book this year is, especially in the context of the pandemic, when we were talking about stimulus packages and ways to help people in the society, well, one of the big things that we could see is to revive journalism with a stimulus package, having a public option, and to actually robustly fund a free press that operates in the public interest without these kinds of conflicts. And I wondered, Andy Lee Roth, if you could say a thing or two about our need for a truly public free press.
Yeah, that story is one of our very top stories in this year's book. And it was originally reported by Craig Aaron in the Columbia Journalism Review and Victor Picard, another great friend of the project, in articles in Jacobin and The Guardian. And I think really what we're talking about here, I mean, in some ways, this goes directly back to the economics of it, what many people would call the political economy of journalism. But I would break it down in very simple terms and say, in terms of a media monopoly, where most of the media we consume, 90%+ of the media we consume, as listeners of this show know, is produced by 5 or 6 mega corporations. The real question to me as a sociologist and when I work at Project Censored is whether we can have a diversity of content when we lack a diversity of ownership. So I think when Craig Aaron, Victor Picard, and others are talking about reviving journalism with public options, with stimulus packages, they're talking about expanding the diversity of ownership, addressing the economic crisis that independent journalistic outlets are also facing, so that we can continue to have a diversity of sources. People often ask me, Andy, isn't it really discouraging working on the top 25 list every year when so many of the stories are negative? And I have two kinds of answers. First is, not all the stories are negative. Almost a third of our stories this year on the top 25 list are solutions-oriented stories, and the revived journalism with a stimulus package and public option story is one of those. But the other way that I remain optimistic, even when the stories are critically inclined and negative in their focus, is that without robust, courageous, independent investigative journalism, we would not even know about these stories, right? So it's a kind of glass is half full perspective saying it's terrible that these things are happening in the world, but it would be worse still if by relying only on corporate news media, these things were happening and we knew nothing about them.
Well, Andy Lee Roth, thank you so much for spending the hour with us today on the Project Censored Show. Andy Lee Roth is the Associate Director of Project Censored, has done 10 previous versions of Censored's annual book, and is co-editor with me of the new book, Project Censored State of the Free Press 2021, out on 7 Stories Press. Andy Lee Roth, thank you so much again for joining us and talking to us today, not only about the research of Project Censored, but about critical media literacy education and the importance of an independent and truly free press.
Thanks, Mickey.
Supporting human conditions, not free market propaganda and corrupt politicians, because they own by special interest groups that fund their campaign.
You've been listening to the Project Censored Show, established in 2010 by myself along with Peter Phillips. I'm the executive producer, Mickey Huff, of this program, also the host. Our co-host is Chase Palmieri. Anthony Fest, our senior producer. Our associate producer is Dennis Murphy. Thanks to you, our listeners, for tuning in. We'll see you next time.
Political ties, habitualized alibis, disguised under the guise of democracy, politics of the apocalypse. Got the skies looking ominous. So the ocean burned bright with waves full of poison. Genocide wars fall for little poison. The weapons manufactured paid for by attacks upon the bridges and the levees and the mines collapsing. All the prisons filled with capacity citizens. And the times for the master thief, confine, conquer, steal a masterpiece. Open your eyes and realize what's happening. Time's running out to reach all potential. If you ain't at the table, then you're probably on the menu.
We got that love.
Can overthrow the system. We got the love, uplift our brothers.